everyone for joining us for this hallelujah moment. A moment of praising God and joining in song and blessing, and most of all, joining our hearts with tremendous love for this newborn child. This morning we mark together three incredible transitions. A transition from transition into parenthood, celebrating Leah and Daryl becoming parents, a transition from not being into being, from what we call from darkness into light, transition into light, and a transition into naming, the very first steps of having an identity, of a name, as it were, descending from heaven and streaming forth from the heart with a name, revealing just a tiny bit of the essence of this child who was born to these wonderful parents. Hallelujah. So join us together in Igun, in a melody that has meant so much to Leah and Daryl during this during these months and during this moment of transition and birth. I'm going to ask everyone to rise as the baby is brought in. Repeat after me, Baruch Bucha Ba'a. Welcome with blessing, welcome with blessing.
La 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 la
Say the blessing in Hebrew, Daryl Leah will announce the name out loud, and then I'll repeat the blessing in English. Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. May the Holy bless first the mother, Leah Michal, the daughter of Bathsheba, who was given birth, and her newborn daughter, who shall be known as Hadar Yael, the daughter of Nahab and Meir, the Hakohen, born in favor of Bashaas Tova Mazal Tov. Amen.
As we welcome this precious child, Hadar Yael, into our community, we bless her parents and we bless, Hadar Yael, that she continue to grow in the community and be brought up by her parents in the values that they hold so dear. And may she continue to celebrate developmental milestones with the love and support of
Amen.
Bless you, pray you for parents that they may have the merit to raise us to Torah, to the marriage canopy, and to good deeds, and let us say,
Amen.
We're going to take a moment for Leah to say the blessing of Hagomel.
And I want to actually say, so this is a blessing that we say when we've gone through a potentially life-threatening circumstance, and I just want to acknowledge our doula, Amelia, who is here with us today, who totally got me through my 40-hour labor, along with Carol. So I want to acknowledge the people who supported me during that hard process before I came to Brecha. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, Olam Hadomel, L'chayim Tovot, Shigmalani, Kolto. Blessed are you, Lord our God, he who there is to bestow good on the indebted, who has bestowed on me much good.
May the one who bestowed goodness upon you continue to bestow goodness on you all the days of your life. Amen.
Yes. Amen.
And now we're going to say a traditional prayer for children that's usually said on Friday nights. Right before the festive Sabbath meal begins, and we're going to say it together. Yisimeh Elohim Kisara Ritka Rachel Balea Yivarechata Adonai Vayishmarecha Ya'er Adonai Panav Elecha Yitineka Yisa Adonai Panav Elecha Yisim Lecha Shalom. Amen.
May God meet you like Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you.
May the Lord turn his face toward you and grant you peace.
Amen. So the name Hadar came to me and Daryl really easily. We didn't go through a whole list of names, and it just dawned on us one Shabbat afternoon that that should be her name. And she's firstly named after my maternal grandmother, whose Hebrew name is Hannah. And Hadar is also a contemporary Israeli name, which for us reflects our really paradigm-shifting time that we had in Israel together, and continues to connect us to that space and time in our lives. Hadar means glory, splendor, or beauty. And there are three bits of Torah insights that I want to share with you today as it relates to Hadar. The first one is insight from the story of Hannah, the character in the book of Shmuel. The second is insight from the principle of Hidor Mitzvah, the beautification of a commandment or a mitzvah. And then some insight from the Torah of my family that I hope we can pass on to her. So first of all, in the story of Hannah, there are some character traits that I feel like Hannah exemplifies that are similar to my grandmother. In the story, Hannah is greatly distressed because the desires of her heart are not being met, and she wants to have a child, and she's struggling with it, and the men in her life, her husband, Elkanah, and the priest, Eli, are not being so empathetic towards her. And in a moment where she comes to the temple to pray, she's crying and sobbing and pouring her heart out. And it says in verse 15, V'ta'an Hannah v'tomer lo Adoni, Isha kishat ruach anochi v'yayin v'shechar lo shatiti, v'ishkoch et nafshi v'knei Adonai. So Eli comes to her and he he sees that she's crying and she's praying and she's pouring her heart out. Now he comes to her and he accuses her of being drunk. And he tells her she's making a spectacle of herself and that she should sober up. And Hannah responds, which is the verse in Hebrew I just read. She says, "Oh no, my Lord, I'm a very unhappy woman. I have drunk no wine or other strong drink, but I have been pouring my heart out to the Lord." And she continues, "Do not take your maidservant for a worthless woman. I have only been speaking all this time out of my great anguish and distress." And what strikes me about her response is that she's in an incredibly vulnerable moment, in a moment where she could lash out at him, she could shut down and not say anything, she could not stand up for herself, but she doesn't do that. In her vulnerable state, she just calmly and effectively stays grounded and assertive and powerful, but without disrespecting him as a human being and without disrespecting herself. And so I always read this moment in the story as a woman who handles herself with strength, dignity, and grace, and who is still being authentic and true to herself. And the rabbis end up seeing that she's a model for prayer and hold her up as a model that we should all try and embody. And I hope that we can teach her to be a strong woman who stays grounded in herself and her values and allows herself to be vulnerable and doesn't apologize for who she is, but does that with grace and dignity, which are traits that my grandmother had. I'll share a quick story about my grandmother. She was working, I believe at the time, as a secretary, and her boss would not let her off for Rosh Hashanah. And she asked and tried to reason with him, and he wouldn't grant her the time, and so she just didn't show up to work for those days. And instead of letting him determine what should be right for her, she stood her ground and took time off for Rosh Hashanah as she needed to, and let the cards fall where they may. So I feel like there's a connection here between her and Hannah. The second piece of Torah I want to share with you is the idea of Hidor Mitzvah, the beautification of the mitzvah. This is something that's very dear to me, the idea of bringing aesthetics into a life, into a Jewish practice, and it's part of what drew me to Judaism in the first place, to enhance it in a new way in my 20s, whether it's making a beautiful Shabbat table or building a sukkah but then making it amazing and beautiful, enhancing my teaching with students in a beautiful way, or creating a yoga seder, bringing aesthetics to what we're doing and not just having it be bare bones, is something that's really important to me and something that I relate to as an artist who has the aesthetic of dance in my life. And the Midrash, the creative rabbinic commentary, talks about that mitzvot are enhanced by aesthetic dimension, but so is the person who engages in it. So not only does it change the actual action, but the action of engaging aesthetically changes the person themselves. And so the Midrash says, "You are beautiful, my love. You are beautiful through mitzvot, through holy actions, beautiful through deeds of loving kindness and through prayer." It goes on to list a few other actions. But the Midrash seems to suggest there's a reciprocity of beauty through the agency of mitzvot. And so her name, Hadar, because Hidor and Hadar are the same root, Hey, Dalet, Resh, for us feels like it's a reminder that the action of parenting and loving her will be another opportunity for Hidor mitzvah. That we have the opportunity to show her the beauty in the world and that she's elevating our lives in a whole new way with her new little soul being a part of our home. And then lastly, Hadar honors the Torah in my family, which is the values that my mom taught me. My mom was my first dance teacher and taught my siblings and I to bring arts into our lives for me, dance, and for my brother, food, and my sister, music. And she taught us to create beauty in our home through relationships and community and bringing an aesthetic to the space. And she taught me that the value of creating a meaningful life through my career and community to positively impact other people is really important. And she also taught me that my attitude and determination supersedes whatever life circumstances we find ourselves in. And it's always within my power to elevate it.
Amen.
So I just hope that I can continue that tradition in our family and teach her these things. And the name Hadar reminds me to elevate and stay true to these values and pass them on from my grandmother to my mom through me to her. Yeah.
Okay. The middle name, Yael. We just love. We love the way it sounds. It's a great name. So we chose it. but we also chose it for other reasons. She's named after my father, who passed away in 2015. Gerald was his name. And his Hebrew name is Yaakov. So Ya-El, Yaakov, sounds similar. Yaakov was Jacob, the third patriarch that we find in the Old Testament. Just wanted to make a note of a couple of interesting coincidences that transpired over the last couple of weeks since he was born. Hadar was born, Hadar Ya'el. That Sabbath, that Shabbat, the 24th or 5th or 6th, every week we read a different portion of the Old Testament in synagogue on Saturday. That particular portion that we read is called Bishalach in Hebrew. And after we read that portion from the Old Testament, we read a portion from the prophets, the writings, something non-five books of Moses. And that particular thing that we read was the story of Ya'el. Who was Ya'el? She was a heroine in the Book of Kings. And she comes up, and she was a warrior, in my opinion. She comes up in Judges, not Kings, chapter 4 and 5. Another coincidence is my dad passed away in Shvat, the Hebrew month of Shvat, and Hadar was born in the Hebrew month of Shvat. He passed on the 30th, and she was born on the 7th, trying to think of some numerical way to connect them, but the last thing is Ya'el, the character, the woman, the mighty woman in the story of Judges, was from the group of people called the Kenites. And another character in the Old Testament was Jethro. His story shows up in the book of Exodus, and there's a portion read about him. We read it about 2 weeks ago, and it just so happens that that portion is my bar mitzvah portion. So there's all these things going on that are amazing. So just a brief summary of Ya'el, the story. The Jews in, they were conquered by Yavin, the king of the Canaanites. They repented. Deborah, the prophetess at the time, tells the general Barak to go to war against Sisera, who is the general of Yavin. So during the course of the war, God confuses Sisera and his army. And Sisera freaks out and takes off on foot. He just runs and leaves his people, his warriors. He ends up at the tent of Ya'el, and she takes him in. He asks for water and for her to stand guard so that Barak and his warriors don't come in and kill him. Instead, she gives him milk, which makes him fall asleep, and then she takes a tent peg and drives it through his temples, and he's dead. Barak, the general, catches up, and Ya'el shows him the dead general, Sisera. The next chapter in Judges, Deborah the prophetess and Barak the general, seeing Ya'el's praise. So she's got two chapters. And basically, Ya'el did what Barak couldn't. And that's something that I want, that Leah and I will instill into Hadar Ya'el, that she should be able to do what others can't. From the moment that she was born, we've been whispering in her ear that she can be whatever she wants, she can do whatever she wants, within reason. We will support her life choices. And my dad, Yaakov, in my opinion, also did things that others couldn't. He infused my life and my brother and sister with Torah. too came to be an observant Jew later in life and embraced it with a zealousness that I have never seen since. He just took it on. It was almost like one day he was not observant, and then the next day he was. But he still had a foothold. He didn't go crazy. He didn't go off the deep end. You know, he still like lived in the secular world. He worked incredibly hard, 12 to 14 hour days, to put all three of us through private school, grade school, high school, three of us. He had a strong work ethic. And he embraced, like I just said, Judaism with zealousness, rising up early in the morning to go to synagogue before prayer began, to learn Torah, the Old Testament. And he loved physics. Physics was his passion. He majored in physics. He got his PhD in physics. He got his postdoc in physics. From what I understand, his parents wanted him to be a medical doctor. I'm not sure if I'm remembering that correctly. But he said no and went into physics. So in addition to his day job at Abbott Laboratories, where he worked with optics in order to create instruments that would be used for whatever Abbott needed, he tutored high school kids and college kids in math and science. They would come to our house, we'd go to their house. He hustled. He hustled to give us a good life. And he was good at it. He was good at tutoring. I remember I was having such trouble with converting kilometers to centimeters and meters to decimeters and just how do you go from large to small and small to large? And he just cleared it up in a minute. You know, he just said, if you have the higher one, you want to go to the lower one, you just multiply by the gap. And then vice versa. And it just clicked. He had a way of just making things understandable. He was also extremely humble. Just like his namesake, Jacob, Yaakov, in the Old Testament, it says that he was an Ish Tam Yoshev Orali. He was a humble man who sat in his tent. My dad was beyond humble. If you met him in the supermarket, you would never know that he was this like physics genius. He used to fall asleep with Scientific American on his chest, and I was just blown away by how smart he was, and how like he could just do things like at the drop of a hat. I remember from my bar mitzvah, we went to get a suit, and I remember him just like calculating the tax, you know, like just on the fly and something else. Very, just made me be like, wow, my dad's really smart and all that stuff. So I want Hadar to have that temperament also. She's already started like lifting her neck up and she's, you know, progressing great, and you know, we hope that she will be just very successful in life. So we want her to have that temperament as well. And she needs to get done what needs to be done in order to journey successfully through life. Like my dad did. You know, he did what he had to do. He didn't just not do what he had to do. He really worked his tush off to like make our family comfortable. And I'll never forget that. I remember I took my gap year in Israel to learn in a Bible Institute, and we were raising money, or you know, so that I could go. And somehow he was able to secure a $5,000 grant from Abbott Laboratories for my year in Israel, and it was just astounding. So Yael, the name literally means ibex, the animal. I did a little poking around. And the Nubian ibex is indigenous to Israel and the surrounding countries. It's the first animal that I actually saw during my gap year. We would take these tours in the desert and across the Israel country. So it's the only species of ibex that's adapted to life in hot regions. It's got a shiny coat, it's waterproof. I guess she's kind of waterproof, as we've seen over the last couple of days. These ibexes are extremely agile and spend their time in steep mountain terrain. They move up and down the cliffs with ease and agility, which plays a big part in predatory avoidance, so they don't get killed. We obviously don't want a dog to live in mountaintops and take too many risks, but we want her to be adventurous, like her auntie Rachel, who goes all over and does amazing things like mountain climbing and rock climbing and skiing. We want her to take risks and explore this beautiful world that God, Hashem, has given us. And we want her to be able to deal with hard times that we all face. My dad, for sure, saw us through hard times. And we also want her to have levity. We also want her to be able to joke around. My dad was the epitome of a jokester. And whatever she becomes, I just hope that she embraces and takes some of these characteristics from my dad, because he really was an amazing man, and I'll always think of him when I look at her, I'm a beautiful girl. So the last thing was, what last name should we give her? Very challenging, because Laya's last name is Khan, my last name is Cone. We toyed with the idea of Khan Cone. I didn't want her to get beat up on the playground, but we wanted her to have a combination of us. So we decided to name her Khan. Her last name is Khan, which technically is a combination of Cone and Khan. C-O-H-N-K-A-H-N. My brother's got three boys, so the Cone name will live on. But Hadar Yael comes from a long line of powerful women. Her mom, Leah, her Safta Lynn, Leah's mom, her aunt, her grandmother, women in my family, my Aunt Barbara, cousin Jennifer, who are here. And it was important to me and to us that she have that last name. So her full name is Hadar Yael Khan. We actually just got something in the mail that says the parents of Hadar Yael Khan. And it was super bizarre. From Kaiser, the hospital.
They know.
Yeah, so that's it.
This is, for us, it's a kavanah, us setting our intention of being co-creators with Hadar and not just lording over her what we want her to be, but watching her and cultivating her and seeing what her spirit is like. And so this is not a blessing for creation, but a blessing for creating, which is the studio before art is made. And it's appropriate, as Daryl and I have been even more shocked that we created a human being after she came out than when I was pregnant. And we've been very struck by our ability to create and what that means, and are still in disbelief about it. So this is a blessing for creating. We bless the source of life that has created us in his image and invited us to renew every day and always the works of creation. Blessed is the creator of creations. We want to thank all of you for coming, and we feel so excited that in this room there are dancers and artists and programmers and people who are committed to Jewish community and Hillel professionals and students. We're so excited that the community we've created, that she'll have that community also, and that you're all part of that experience for her.
And neighbors, and new friends, and lots of different people from all walks of life.
So we're going to close with some dancing, and then everyone's invited to the social hall for some refreshments.
And we just wanted to call out our amazing clergy, Rabbi Cohn and Maharat Sutton. Maharat's been ridiculously amazing, helping us on every front. And again, another shout out to Amelia, who, you know, I consider myself pretty able-bodied, but we would not have been able to survive.
Two nights at home laboring to cover.
I mean, to the point where Amelia was like curled up on like two pillows at Leo's on the couch, Amelia was like curled up on two pillows right there, I was curled up on the couch as well. Just thank you so much.